This is Tanavish and I am a positive psychologist here at Elsevier. And my colleagues and I are here to talk to you about well-being. In the past recent years, we have heard these words get thrown around quite frequently. Well-being, wellness, welfare. So, what do these mean? We need to clarify each of these terms as they often get confused with one another. Wellness is defined as a state of being well or in good health, often focused on achieving physical health. On the other hand, welfare, while often synonymous with well-being, is more focused toward a social effort to promoting basic physical and material needs of people. Well-being refers to a more holistic experience encompassing physical, mental, and emotional wellness and can be defined as a state of being content, comfortable, happy, and healthy. While there is no formal consensus on the definition of well-being, the World Health Organization defines mental health as a state of well-being in which an individual realizes their own potential, are able to cope with the daily life stressors, can work productively and fruitfully, and are able to make a contribution to their community. Therefore, a well-being organization such as ourselves at Elsevier aims to help people identify their strengths to reach their potential, utilizing the science of well-being, positive psychology, and happiness research. While the concept of well-being is something that is relatively new, the idea of happiness has been around for a long time across various philosophies, religions, and cultural traditions. Greek philosopher Aristotle first talked about this idea of happiness as a product of a well-lived life, a full flourishing existence, a complete life. The idea of happiness continued to resonate amongst the early Christians, where followers of the faith were given promises of redemption through suffering and of everlasting happiness in the afterlife. Writers and philosophers had promoted this idea of wellness with presidents like Thomas Jefferson talking about the rights of the American people, among which are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. In recent years, well-being has its role within the sustainable goals put forth by the United Nations. The idea of using science to help people started from medicine to psychiatry to psychology, where the goal was to understand and treat psychological suffering. However, there has been a shift within the field from alleviating emotional pain towards focusing on the positive aspects about human nature, working towards one's strength, and using them to help one reach their maximum potential in life.
So, why is well-being important? Well, well-being encompasses physical, psychological, emotional health, leading to increased productivity, better relationships, and physical and mental health. We will talk about the various aspects and theories of well-being, ways in which one can improve their well-being, and also highlight the global well-being movement.
Hi everyone, welcome to the next section, Understanding Well-being, the Types and Theories of Well-being. I'm Vinny, a positive psychologist from Elsevier organization, and in this part of the video, we are going to dive into a bit on what exactly is well-being. What do you think is the true essence of well-being? How many different types of well-being do you think there are? Or what are some of the most popular theories and models of well-being that you've heard of? So have you heard of any of these concepts before, or does it all sound very new to you? Now, whatever may be your knowledge related to well-being, I'm here to help you understand these well-being concepts that we are going to discuss now. So ready? Let's begin. In the previous section of the video, my colleague had discussed about the World Health Organization's definition of well-being. So now, will you be able to point out the two most key components of well-being? It is A, feeling good, and B, functioning well. Now, knowing what well-being encompasses, let's move a little further into the different types of well-being. There are mainly two types of well-being, which is objective and subjective well-being, of which subjective well-being is again further divided into three kinds, which we will discuss a little later. Now let's delve into what each of these types of well-being are. So objective well-being. Now this is more of a proxy measure based on aspects such as whether you have your basic human needs or rights, such as adequate food, physical health, safety, etc. So objective well-being can thus be measured through self-report or other objective measures. So now can you guess what subjective well-being is? Because it's just the opposite of objective well-being. Subjective well-being is also known as personal well-being. This is basically related to how people think, that is the cognitive element, and feel, the affective element, about their own well-being or about their life as a whole. So as I mentioned earlier, this subjective well-being can be divided further into three more aspects. The hedonic aspect, which translates into the pleasant life. That is, the hedonic aspect deals with pleasure attainment and pain avoidance. Then comes the eudaimonic, or also known as the psychological aspect, which translates into the meaningful life, and this deals with meaning and self-realization. And finally, the life satisfaction aspect translates into evaluation of one's life. So now, if you may wonder what is ideal subjective well-being, to clarify, Dina, a psychologist, explains that it is the experience of high levels of pleasant emotions and moods, low levels of negative emotions and moods, and high life satisfaction. Now let's move into the concept of eudaimonic, or the psychological well-being. This concept was further extended and later presented as this concept with six components to it by psychologist Rick. Now what are these six components? One, autonomy. People high in this component have a high sense of self-determination. They're driven by their own standards. Second, environmental mastery, which is the capacity to effectively manage one's life and the surrounding world. Third, personal growth, wherein one is continually looking for opportunities to grow and develop. Fourth, positive relations with others. Here one is engaged in mutually satisfying, warm, and trusting relationships. Fifth, purpose in life component, that is being able to identify and pursue meaningful goals in your life. And sixth, self-acceptance, having a positive attitude about one's personality and self. Hence, this six-component model of eudaimonic or psychological well-being is based on the assumption that individuals can strive to function fully and realize their potential. So now, as you've understood that eudaimonic well-being is more of a private phenomena, that is in regard to one's own private lives, now there is this another separate well-being concept. That is, it doesn't necessarily come under the objective or subjective well-being concepts, and this is social well-being, developed by psychologist Keyes. And this is what deals with public phenomena. That is, it is the social tasks encountered by adults in their social lives. Underlying this concept of social well-being are five factors. It represents the extent to which individuals are overcoming social challenges and are functioning well. And these are, one, social integration. And this is if you feel like as if you're united with and supported by other members of your own community. The second component is social contribution. Here, one believes oneself to be a valuable and appreciated member of society. The third component, social coherence. This is where you perceive order and meaning in your relationships and society. Fourth, social actualization. This is where an individual believes that other individuals and institutions of society are helping me or you to achieve one's full potential. And the fifth, social acceptance. Here one is comfortable with and have favorable views of others. So basically, if you want to know how well you're functioning in your social world, then these are the measures of social well-being to look into. Now let's move forward to some of the models and theories of well-being. But here I'm only going to discuss two of the more well-known models of well-being. The first of this kind is the PERMA model by Martin Seligman, who's known as the father of positive psychology. In his PERMA model, he talks about the elements of well-being, which he believes are the core building blocks for a flourishing life. So PERMA is actually an acronym, where P stands for positive emotions. Now these are your feel-good emotions, like happiness, optimism, etc. E, engagement, meaning when you experience a state of flow, where you're so connected to your work and hobbies. R, relationships. These are your authentic social interactions and connections. M, meaning. This is where you have purpose in life or have realistic goals that is of some personal meaning to you. And A, accomplishments, taking pride in yourself and in your achievements. So these five core elements can help people reach a life of fulfillment, contentment, and meaning, and thus are directly related to psychological well-being and happiness. And finally, the other well-known theory on well-being is the balance theory of well-being by psychologists George and colleagues. This theory states that well-being is the balance point between an individual's resource pool and the challenges he or she faces. So now when you look at this image, you can see how well-being is at the center point of the seesaw, with social, physical, and psychological resources and challenges on either end of the seesaw. The seesaw itself represents an individual's drive to return to their well-being to the center point. So as you see, well-being is affected by the resources gained and lost and the challenges faced. Suppose there are no challenges, then stagnation occurs. So there you go. We've discussed all that well-being is, its types and models. We've now come to the end of this topic. Hope you've gained many insights from all that we've discussed here.
Hi, my name is Dr. Ogbonnaya Nkwole, a positive psychologist at Sue Well Organization. My colleagues have just discussed the definition, theories, types, models of well-being. I am now to discuss the core components of well-being. Psychological well-being consists of more than 14 variables, according to Dr. Yino Longo of University of Nottingham, England. They are happiness, compassion, gratitude, vitality, self-awareness, self-acceptance, flourishing, optimism, self-worth, calmness, competence, development, purpose, significance, congruence, connections. In the presentation, because of time factor, I will restrict myself to three variables, namely happiness, optimism, flourishing. Happiness. Happiness can be defined as a state of feeling of positive emotion like joy, life satisfaction, moment of pleasure, contentment, cheerfulness, delight, enjoyment. A happy person is at peace with himself, spouse, children, friends, community, state, and government of his country. His life is not absence of negative emotions like sadness, anger, stress, anxiety, and depression. Just like erroneously believe that he doesn't have those things. But he has the ability to ignore all those things and move forward happily. Happiness promotes good relationships, physical well-being, social well-being, mental well-being, physiological well-being. Number two, optimism. Optimism is a mental attitude reflecting a belief or a hope that the outcome of some specific endeavor or outcome in general will be positive, favorable, and desirable. Optimism is also defined as expecting the best possible outcome from any given situation. It is a form of positive thinking that includes the belief that you are responsible for your own happiness and that good things than bad will continue to happen to you. Optimists believe that bad or negative events are rare occurrences and it is not their own fault when something bad happens, but it is due to something external that beyond their control. Let us now do a very interesting activity. Please follow the YouTube link given in the description box to access the brief video from a famous movie, Life is Beautiful, from Roberto Benigni, played the role of Jewish bootkeeper who has been taken captive in Jewish concentration camp along with his wife and son. The video depicts the first day at the concentration camp where he attempted to depict a Holocaust camp as a game so that his son can survive the horrors of the Jewish concentration camp. Please watch the video carefully and spot the area where Roberto Benigni displays this optimism and develop yours. The next one, flourishing. Flourishing, according to Seligman, Steen, Park, and Peterson, is a state where people experience positive emotion, positive psychological functioning, and positive social functioning most of the time. In most philosophical terms, this means access to pleasant life, engaged life, good life, and meaningful life. It requires the development of attributes, social and personal level, that exhibit character strength and virtue that is commonly agreed across different cultures. Individuals described as flourishing have a combination of high level of emotional well-being, psychological well-being, and social well-being. Flourishing people are happy and satisfied. They tend to see their life as having a purpose. They feel some degree of mastering and accept all parts of themselves as good. And so you will also develop happiness, optimism, and flourishing so that your well-being life will be okay.
So, after learning so much about well-being, you must be wondering, how can I measure my well-being? The two most common measures of well-being are the Psychological Well-being Scale and the Warwick-Edinburgh Mental Well-being Scale. The Psychological Well-being Scale was developed by Carol Rift. It is designed to assess an individual's well-being at a particular moment in time within each of these six dimensions: autonomy, environmental mastery, personal growth, positive relations with others, purpose in life, and self-acceptance. Higher scores indicate greater well-being on each of these dimensions. You can access the scale by clicking the link given below in the description box. The next is Warwick-Edinburgh Mental Well-being Scale. This is a 14-item scale of mental well-being covering subjective well-being and psychological functioning, and addresses aspects of positive mental health. Now that you know how to measure your well-being, let us find out the different ways of increasing your well-being. 50% of the variation in subjective well-being is due to genetics, and 10% is due to circumstantial factors. In this view, the key to improvement of subjective well-being lies in the remaining 40%, which includes so-called intentional activities. Intentional activities are defined as simple, intentional, and regular practices meant to mimic the myriad of healthy thoughts and behaviors associated with naturally happy people. In his book Flourish, psychologist Martin Seligman proposes the PERMA model, the need for a balance between five different components of life, that is positive emotions, engagement, relationships, meaning, and accomplishment, as we had discussed earlier too. When you master these, you will increase your happiness and feeling of well-being. Now let's look into how we can increase and apply each of these five components of the PERMA model to our day-to-day life through some activities and such. So the first, how to lead a life of positive emotions. Now in the book Positivity, Dr. Barbara Fredrickson discusses creating a mindset of positivity by being open, appreciative, curious, kind, and real. The next activity will demonstrate how we can increase positive emotions in our lives. So how can you design happiness?
I think you could begin by observing your own days, both the good ones and the not so good ones. Become aware of the activities, situations, or circumstances that cause some days to be good and other days to be not so good. Are there certain activities, situations, or circumstances that consistently seem to contribute to a negative evaluation of a day? If so, list them and reflect on what you could do or not do to have more days in which you engage in the activities that make for a good day. The next point of the PERMA model is on how to lead a life of engagement. Do you feel engaged in your personal and professional life? Seek out activities that allow you to be in a state of flow. Try to identify what you're good at and what you just love to do, even if you're not paid for it, and look for opportunities to engage. The third is relationship. As humans, we are social beings, and good relationships are core to our well-being. People who have meaningful and positive relationships with others are happier than those who do not. The following activity will help you build positive relationships in your life. It is known as the Active and Constructive Responding, ACR. Active and constructive responding is the most effective way to respond, giving both the deliverer of good news and the listener a positive outcome. The other three ways include passive and constructive, active and destructive, and passive and destructive. So now let's learn what ACR is. How do you react to a friend when they share good news? Imagine your partner comes home from work and announces that she received a promotion at work. There are many ways in which you could respond to this news. An ACR responder might say, "That's amazing. I knew they would recognize your hard work. Let's celebrate." When people share good news, they want you to share in their joy. And this goes far beyond just a pat on the back. Conveying authentic interest, pride, and even curiosity in someone's good news are all hallmarks of ACR. The fourth domain of PERMA is meaning. Meaning comes from serving a cause or focusing on something bigger than ourselves. Most of us want to believe that we're working and living with a greater purpose. What ignites you, gets you out of bed in the morning? Having meaning is like having a compass that provides direction and a sense of purpose. Simon Sinek says, "It's not what we do, it's why we do it." And the final domain is accomplishment or achievement. Many of us strive to better ourselves in some way, whether we're seeking to master a skill, achieve a goal, or win a competition. Well-being is enhanced by taking forward steps and is less about the goal itself. Accomplishment can come from devoting time and energy to what has meaning or celebrating each small new learning. There is also another area which can help us improve our well-being. Research shows the single best predictor of well-being is gratitude. The three good things exercise, also known as the three blessings, is arguably one of the most well-known exercises to increase well-being by practicing gratitude. This exercise entails writing down three good things that went well and reflecting on these things at the end of each day. To maintain a feeling of well-being, all of these needs must be met and balanced. Try applying the 20-80 rule to your life. Spend 20% of your time on small mindful practices such as exercise, meditation, reading, appreciation, and gratitude. When you do, you'll find that you're able to handle 80% of your day in a positive way. No matter what circumstances you encounter, remember, it doesn't take great changes to make you happy. It's the small acts of self-love, mindfulness, and appreciation that matter.
So, we have come to the end of this talk. Good mental health and well-being mean different things to different people, and every person has to find their own way to a life that is meaningful and satisfying for them. Global well-being and health is defined by the growing institution of data that records and analyze almost all topics affecting all aspects of life for the benefit of the 6 billion people of the world and those who need them. Health is not only absence of illness, it means measures of basic needs, safety, mental health, physical health, employment, work, respect, citizen engagement, and national leadership, among others. Some researchers have also demonstrated that various aspects of well-being have healthy effects on important life outcomes. Research has proven across a variety of important life domains, like work, family, friendship, and health. Fit individuals who report higher levels of happiness or well-being report improved outcomes in each of the life domains. Beyond feeling good, high level of well-being promotes positive outcomes in a variety of domains. Perhaps the most widely known example of well-being policy comes from the nation of Bhutan. One study found that Bhutan ranked 8th on well-being on a list of 178 countries. In February 2016, the UAE government created the post of Minister of State for Happiness. The main responsibility was to harmonize all government plans, programs, and policies to achieve a happier society. In 2017, the ministry renamed the minister as the Minister of State for Happiness and Wellbeing. In the United Kingdom, Prime Minister David Cameron supported the establishment of the MAVIN National Wellbeing Program. The program aims to measure the UK national wellbeing beyond that its economic standing and looks at social, personal, and environmental well-being as well. Smaller scale well-being improvement efforts have also been taking place around the world. For example, the state of Vermont in the United States has taken a statewide well-being approach to help citizens thrive. Similarly, the city of Bahia in Brazil has also focused on the well-being of its citizens as a viable policy goal. So, we see that governments across nations as well as the United Nations have started recognizing the importance of well-being as a sustainable goal.